Anglo-Saxon kings helped the spread of Christianity, but it was not all plain sailing, as some kings slipped into apostasy, and there were homespun Christian heretics.
We recorded that King Ethelbert of Kent appointed London the episcopal see for Mellitus and built a church for its first bishop. Bede tells us that London was the capital of the East Saxons. Their king was Ethelbert's nephew, Sebert, implying that Ethelbert as Bretwalda probably enjoyed some authority in King Sebert's lands. The church was dedicated to St. Paul the Apostle. It may even have been built on the site of, or have included, a former pagan temple, which, as we saw earlier, Pope Gregory permitted after depaganization. It was replaced by a Norman cathedral that was destroyed by the Great Fire of London in 1666, on the ashes of which rose Sir Christopher Wren's sublime St. Paul's. Its inspiring dome, thanks to the Prince of Wales, once more dominates that part of the London skyline as you cross south to north over the River Thames at Waterloo Bridge. The first St. Paul's was built of stone. It would have been important to King Ethelbert to make a building that stood out and to gratify the sensibilities of the priests who would occupy it, for they were reliable supporters and their religion, which he had adopted, underpinned his regime with divine authority. The priests were also literate and must have devised with the king the first extant Anglo-Saxon law code. Written law, as we know, makes for more effective government because it becomes a permanent first reference of what is illegal and the punishments that are appropriate for infractions. It was copied probably at the time and distributed to the new bishops of London and Rochester, perhaps to important abbeys and monasteries. Bede copied it more than 100 years later in his history, and there must surely have been other copies long since lost. So the law would have been fairly widely disseminated. Little is known of what London was like at this time. Historians such as Bede and the authors of the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle were mostly concerned with church, royal and aristocratic matters in that order. There is a brief mention in Bede of Frisian merchants in London in 679. One of the greatest travellers of the 8th century was St. Willibald, a monk at Bishop's Waltham, Hampshire, who wrote the first travelogue by an Englishman called the Hodoeporicon. He also managed to fit in what we might describe as a shopping expedition when he sailed from Southampton to the market at Rouen in Normandy and back in 720. There is a letter from Emperor Charlemagne to King Offer of Mercia about a trade treaty. We shall treat with Willibald and Offer later on. Such formal roads as there may have been had been laid centuries before by the Romans, as also stone buildings. London's fortifications seem to have been strengthened at the end of the 3rd century AD. Excavations of Roman villas recently have uncovered mosaics that include Christian motifs suggesting 4th century construction. Anglo-Saxons hardly seem to have lived in towns, and when some of them eventually settled in them, archaeologists have determined that Roman street plans were ignored. They built their ground houses as they liked, without regard to the lie of the streets that had been built by the Romans on a grid plan. The Romans occupied Britain south of Hadrian's Wall, repaired by Emperor Septimus Severus between 205 and 208. Bede mentions their cities, forts, bridges and paved roads, which, when he was writing in the 730s, bore witness to Roman endeavour. Richard Hodges wrote a useful article in the monthly magazine History Today, drawing together some of the archaeological strands to suggest that Hamwic, now Southampton, had an important Saxon cemetery, and later in the 7th century, a market. both indicate a permanent resident population. There might have been a defensive and trading community there from earliest Anglo-Saxon times, the 5th century. A grave in the same period at Ipswich, Suffolk, it's been proposed, was that of a Wiccareffa, or King's Steward, who did devise a grid plan for the town covering some 120 acres. A similar plan may have existed for the area of Covent Garden, central London. This was an important wholesale vegetable and flower market until the 1970s. Only kings could have had the wherewithal and the power to make such things happen. Kings would have been aware of the revenues that could be exacted from merchants and people in their daily dealings for food, clothes, household utensils, personal adornment. Sadly, the chronicles are mostly silent on such mundane matters. But we can infer that indirect imposts on the retail and import-export trade would have been a valuable supplement to the forms of royal land or hidage services and taxes, which we shall encounter later. Ports were markets primarily, where a docked boat's owner might have put out his cargo for sale to merchants who carried their purchases onwards. Although of Latin origin, port was a word well known in Old English, and inland place names that begin or end with it, like Portland and Southport, often signify a market, many of which throve for centuries because there were no shops. London was a port like Southampton. Their geography has not changed, and both places remain important ports, where the modern royal taxes of excise, duties and VAT are assessed and collected, contributing tens of billions to the exchequer today. Archaeology and writings imply that the public areas of some cathedrals and abbeys, founded from about the 7th century, were built of stone, where trade might take place after divine service, as foreshadowed by Pope Gregory in his letter to Abbot Mellitus. The living quarters of priests, nuns and monks and other outbuildings would probably have been constructed of wood. The first written reference in the Anglo-Saxon chronicle I've found to foundations, hinting at the possible use of stone or brick, is from the Peterborough manuscript, dated 654. King Oswy of Northumbria, then in the ascendant among the kings in England, ordered a minster to be built and dedicated to St. Peter at Medeshamsted, now Peterborough.
And they began the foundations and built upon them, and then entrusted it to a monk who was called Seaxwulf. He was a very great friend of God, and all the people loved him, and he was very nobly born in the world, and powerful.
Seaxwulf was a bishop and Peterborough's first abbot. Of course, foundations could have been laid on wooden sleepers, but why should Bede have mentioned foundations otherwise? It's tempting to speculate that, in the case of a royal church as important as Peterborough Abbey, its main structure would have been built of stone. In London, the Roman wall enclosed about 300 acres. It was 18 feet high and between 6 and 9 feet thick. There were 8 gates, more than 20 defensive towers, and a ditch on the outside. In the Church of All Hallows by the tower is a Saxon arch made from salvaged Roman bricks, and this kind of reclamation of materials must have occurred all over the country. Roman glass would soon be being recycled to make the first English stained glass. We left King Aethelbert granting the bishop's seat at London to Mellitus. Aethelbert was the first of the English kings to receive baptism, but on his death in 616, his son and successor, Eadbald, abandoned Christianity, the Anglo-Saxon chronicle.
At this time, Laurentius was Archbishop of Canterbury, and because of the grief he had as a result of the king's unbelief, he had decided to abandon all this land and travel across the sea. But St. Peter the Apostle scourged him fiercely one night, because he wanted to abandon God's flock thus, and ordered him boldly to instruct the king in the true faith. And he did so, and the king turned to the truth.
This section of the Canterbury manuscript, and many others in the chronicle, indicate how impermanent Christianity was at first among the Anglo-Saxons. Eadbald was succeeded by his son, Eorcenberht, as king of Kent in 640, who, the chronicle tells us, overthrew all devil worship. So almost 50 years after St. Augustine's mission, paganism still had adherents among the first Christianized English settlers. Bede tells us of King Erpwald of the East Angles, who was persuaded in 627.
He was persuaded to abandon his superstitious idolatry and accept the faith and sacraments of Christ with his whole province. His father, Radwald, had in fact long before this received Christian baptism in Kent, but made no good purpose. For on his return home, his wife and certain perverse advisers persuaded him to apostatize from the true faith. So his last state was worse than his first, for, like the ancient Samaritans, he tried to serve both Christ and the ancient gods, and he had in the same shrine an altar on which the victims were offered to devils. Adwulf, king of that province who lived into our own times, testifies that this shrine was still standing in his day, and that he had seen it as a boy.
Disunity among Christians at the time was hardly helpful, and Augustine was not above taking sides in what we might call the battle for hearts and minds in Britain. Dating it as 603, Bede tells the story of an attempt by Augustine to bring the British Christians in Wales into obedience to the Catholic Church in Rome. Remember that the Britons had been Christianized towards the end of the Roman occupation of the island, which ended in about 400. Theological developments in Rome may well have been restricted because England and its nearest neighbor, France, were war zones, ruled over by warlords, many of them pagan, as we've seen. Roman popes had, in these years, been surviving men like Attila the Hun and other conquerors, including resurgent Eastern emperors in Italy itself. Remember also that, in common with most other religions which I've had any familiarity, converting pagans was perhaps not as important as enforcing conformity among Christians, or worse, those Christians who were seen as heretics. Where there were deviant Christians, getting papal authority in Rome established appears to have been the priority. Augustine had got the agreement of the Welsh bishops to meet at a council, location now unknown, to determine their differences. Bede picks up the story of the bishops' reaction when, on their entrance, Augustine failed to get up from his chair to receive them.
Seeing this, they became angry, accusing him of pride and taking pains to contradict all he said. Augustine then declared, "There are many points on which your customs conflict with ours, or rather with those of the universal church. Nevertheless, if you agree with me on 3 points, I am ready to countenance all your other customs, although they are contrary to our own. These points are: to keep Easter at the correct time, to complete the sacrament of baptism, by which we are reborn to God according to the rites of Holy, Roman, and Apostolic Church, and to join with us the preaching of the Word of God to the English." But the bishops refused these things, nor would they recognize Augustine as their archbishop, saying among themselves that if he would not rise to greet them in the first instance, he would have even less regard for them once they submitted to his authority. Whereupon Augustine, that man of God, is said to have answered with a threat that was also a prophecy. If they refused to accept peace with fellow Christians, they would be forced to accept war at the hands of enemies. And if they refused to preach to the English way of life, they would eventually suffer at their hands the penalty of death.
Note that Augustine failed to rise when the British delegation arrived. It is so often the little things that stir up the greatest anger among human beings. Nor did Augustine select diplomatic words, and I sense Bede thinking that these Welsh prelates got their comeuppance soon after, when the pagan King Aethelfrith of Northumbria met a Christian nonconformist Welsh army in battle at Chester. Hearing that the Welsh had brought priests with them, who Aethelfrith assumed were praying for his defeat, the Northumbrian leader directed his attack first against them, killing 1,200 of them, so it is said. He then killed what the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle describes as a countless number of Welsh. Some religious folk, even Bede, tend to reserve their greatest hatred for their own heretics.
We shall continue this theme in the next episode. Christianity was established in Britain under the Romans. The faith spread once St. Augustine arrived, being adopted by the Anglo-Saxon rulers, who were sometimes succeeded by apostates.